Vincent, did you want to start?
We're trying to figure out who's going to start, so I guess I'll try.
I want to start.
Can you hear me?
Brigid wants to start?
Heaven's sakes.
Well, because something wasn't mentioned in the introduction, and that are the books that Bob Colacello has done on other important figures. And he did do one of the greatest books on Ronnie and Nancy Reagan. And part two, The White House Years, is coming.
Eventually. That's actually the only other biography I've written, to say, so biographies plural is pretty narrow. But I have done a lot of mini biographies for Vanity Fair in the last 30 years, believe it or not. I don't know, Vincent, I'm going to throw it back to Vincent.
I was just thinking about the current issue of Interview Magazine, where Bob's interviewed, and inside that interview he mentions the fact that Brigid and myself have been his close friends for all these years since the beginning, and I think it's kind of amazing that the three of us are still one, standing, two, still like each other and see each other as much as we can. So,
yeah, I think maybe each one of us should say how we met Andy and got started working with Andy. Start with Brigid, because she started first, no?
Well, I'd just gotten divorced, and it was right after Kennedy was shot. And I met this group of crazies called Rotten Rita. Billy Name, Roger Trudeau, Ondine,
Pope Ondine,
and I was kind of having a little thing with Rotten Rita. He lived on 81st Street in the West Side, and he had a grand piano, and the only thing that you would hear would be Maria Callas 24 hours a day. Between Ondine and Billy and Rotten, it was Maria. But Billy worked as Henry Gelzeller's maid. And I did not know Henry. But Billy invited me over to Henry's house.
And Henry was the curator of modern art at the Metropolitan.
Art at the Met. And it was the most fascinating apartment, because it was the first loft bed that I'd ever seen that had steps going up to it. And all I wanted to do was spend the night there and walk up and down the steps. And it had all of these Al Hansen paintings on the wall of the Hershey bars. But then Billy would always tell me, "Bridge, you've got to get out now, because Henry's coming back." And meanwhile, Billy and I were taking tons of amphetamine. Never anything in the arms. I've never had anything in the arms. And I've never had any other drug except methamphetamine then. I haven't had anything since 74, and I still swear it must have been better then, because I could really stay up for days.
And she was very organized.
So when did you meet Andy?
So when I did meet Henry by mistake.
Henry or Andy?
Henry. No. Henry and I got to like each other. And Henry walked me over from 81st Street in the West Side to the first 47th Street factory between 2nd and 3rd with the old crazy service elevator and what have you. And I went there for the first time with Henry, and I never left. I mean, the place was a mess. It was disgusting. It was all silver foil walls. It was dirty old couches with no stuffing in them. Andy was not into tape recording then, but he had a Ewer, the German reel-to-reel machine, and he used to send me to the back, to this couch that had a curtain, and he'd say, just talk into it. Well, I just hold this microphone. I'm still dying to know if those have ever been found and what I must have said. Because at that time, I was going to all these chic doctors. Dr. Max Jacobson, who was Jack Kennedy's doctor. Dr. Robert Fryman, whose office looked like the store club. And there were bottles of champagne in the treatment room and fresh strawberries every day. And I went in with a Chanel suit, and I was too scared to have a shot in the arm because I don't have veins. Doctors can't even get them. And he had this big tulip vase on his leather tool desk. He was beautifully turned out.
Fryman,
the tiny polka dot tie, you know, beautiful Seville rose suits. And there was this tulip vase filled with these lavender pills. We call them lavender lilies. And so Dr. Fryman took me back into the treatment room, and I had a Chanel scarf around my neck. And at that time, I was running around with Ahmet Erdogan and Prince Dimitri Guarini Miraldi. And he took the scarf from around my neck and he blindfolded himself with like a V. And he said, I'm going to make you feel like no man has ever made you feel. And he did it. And I flew out of that office to Bloomingdale.
Where did he poke?
Wait, what about Andy?
Yeah, I was about to say, we have to get back on track a little bit now.
Well, that's how all started. And then it got to be Andy, and I was poking in my fanny.
In Chelsea Girls, you might remember that scene, some of you who are
Chelsea Girls,
a little older. Or maybe you've seen it in college. Is it a classic now?
Yeah.
All right, Vincent, when did you meet Andy and how?
I met Andy in 1969, August to be exact. I came across country with two other friends, and we were a band, or looked like a band, called The Babies. We didn't play instruments, which was a big problem. But we got to the back of Max's Kansas City the first evening we were there, because we had a whole look of very long hair, very L.A. rock and roll look. And Mickey Ruskin, who was very selective at the door in the evenings, led us into the back room at midnight. And that's where I first laid eyes on Brigid, probably the first two or three times I was in Max's, because the German television crew was in there and they paid her $10 or $20 to try to knock off Candy Darling's wig or the manager's wig. And Brigid wasn't very physical, but her mouth was the force. So that caught my attention. I knew all about her, so I met Andy within 3 days of being in New York, and I went up to a studio with my two friends. We brought Mexican theatrical masks, and Andy had that Euro tape recorder. And my two friends had met him 6 months before they left, and I ended up spending like 2 or 3 hours being interviewed by Andy, which I didn't realize I was going to spend the afternoon. I had been a big fan of his in high school. There was probably four of us that even knew his name in Point Loma High School in San Diego at that time. But that's how it started, and I didn't realize from that moment on, I started freelancing, I would become a lifer. it evolved.
And Vincent... Vincent and I, every morning, I would get there. He was the one reason I really trust Vincent beyond anyone I know, is because Andy only trusted Vincent to go to the bank.
He was Vincent, Andy's private Swiss banker. You are of Swiss origin, aren't you, a little bit?
No, French.
And Vincent used to sit in his office, and this is what it was like. Vincent's office with nothing but cartons that Andy would fill with the crap.
Well, we shared
should
a
say
desk,
that this was 33 Union Square West.
The beginning of the big, when I first met him, was 33 Union Square West, but he had been the attempted assassination by Valerie Solanas was roughly a year before I met Andy's, but there was still no security. I mean, there was a Dutch door, the half the top part was open. I don't, you know.
Well, by the time I got there in 1970, there was a bulletproof
door. The bulletproof
door
came a little bit later, 71, 72.
Really?
Was that Vito Acconci?
It was a bullet.
That was art.
No, I remember a steel door with a little window.
Yeah, there was
one. You had to press a bell.
That was after the armed robbery. That was the last one.
Yeah, because maybe you...
I missed it by about 4 or 5 minutes, but somehow somebody's written about it that I was there, but I literally was going to a movie, so I missed out, but that was the last straw. Then we got a bulletproof door, so if you came up to 33 Union Square, sixth floor, the elevator would open, you'd see this gray door with a little window, which was
the whole
serious
vestibule was made out of sheetrock, so anyone could like punch the hole through the sheetrock.
But that was 860 Broadway.
On the other side of the door was the stuffed Dalmatian.
See, that's 860.
Well, everyone said it was Cecil B. DeMille's dog, but then when that came out in the newspaper one day, his sister threatened to sue.
Right.
Saying her brother would never have stuffed his dog.
Just to backtrack, the bulletproof with the sheetrock was 860 Broadway. We took it with us when we left 33 Union Square West.
But wasn't it 33 Union Square West?
No, 33 Union Square West, you came right off, there was hard walls. There was sheetrock, but you couldn't get off the elevator unless we opened that door. That's when Paul America showed up one day, just out of prison. That was scary.
Because I sort of remember looking at Andy through the bulletproof door. He was sitting at the little Art Deco desk.
When you first came?
Yeah, having lunch, which was purees, because the shooting had left his stomach all torn up, and he wore a girdle for the rest of his life to kind of hold it.
And dyed them?
Bridget, who else? And he was eating these like spinach and carrot purees from Brownie's Health Food Store on 16th Street. And what happened is I was at Columbia University Film School, and for the film criticism class, the professor was Andrew Saris, who was the lead critic for the Village Voice, and the Village Voice then was, you know, the paper of sort of downtown and the counterculture and all of that. And we had a review of film a week, and the ones he liked the best he would publish in the Village Voice. So he published a few reviews of mine, and I got a call from this man named Soren Angenou. Soren was after Kierkegaard. Ingenue was like ingenue. He didn't look very ingenue.
No.
He had this weird little, he had this hair with this like a 1-inch ponytail with a rubber band. And his office, the interview, the factory was on the sixth floor of 33 Union Square West, which also housed the Communist Party of America and Saul Steinberg's
studio. Saul Steinberg on top.
On top. And then on the 10th floor was the interview office, which was actually a storage room, basically. And it was very tiny, and it was filled with several back issues. They'd only done about maybe 6 or 7 issues at that point. It started in 69. And so he's the one who called me and said Andy wanted to meet me, and Paul Morrissey wanted to meet me. And so I went up and met, you know, to his office. Then he took me down to meet Andy, and Andy said, "Oh, hi, OG. Well, we really like the way you write, and would you like to have some lunch?" And he like passed me a spoon, plastic spoon, and I was like, Andy Warhol's like offering to share his lunch with me, because he was one of my idols in college. I'd gone to Georgetown, and I had like Mick Jagger and El Cordobez and William Burroughs, and Andy was in this little pantheon of people who I thought was the coolest and the hippest, because I'd seen Chelsea Girls about 5 or 6 times, starring Brigid Berlin. And, you know, I loved the Marilyn and Elvis and Liz paintings, because those were all movie stars I loved anyway. So, I mean, that was, I think, part of Andy's popular appeal, was that his pop art was popular. I mean, the subject matter was popular to start off with. So we had a pretty big base to work with. He had all the Elvis fans, all the Marilyn fans, all the Camel Soup eaters. And anyway, it sort of evolved pretty quickly from writing a few film reviews to one day Andy saying, I went up to the 10th floor to hand in a film review, and it was all padlocked. And so I went down to the 6th floor, and Andy let me in, and I said, "What happened? You know, where's Soren? Why is it all locked up?" He said, "Oh, talk to Paul. Paul wants to talk to you." So I went to see Paul Morrissey at the other side of the office, and he said, "Oh, you know, we had to fire Soren. He was kind of, I don't know, he was stealing money, basically." And he said, "We thought you should be the new editor." And I was like, Me? I'm, you know, still at film school. I never really edited. Well, I did edit with Glenn O'Brien. We did one issue. Georgetown didn't have a big literary community. We had once a year a literary magazine. I edited that with Glenn O'Brien, who, anyway, Paul said, look, we thought you can be the editor. We'll pay you $40 a week. So I said, $40 a week, even in 1970, this was not very much money. He said, well, it's a part-time job, and you could get credits from Columbia. Go talk to Andrew Saris. So I said, all right, let me come back tomorrow. And I did talk to Andrew Saris. He said, you should do it, but be careful. And we will give you some credits. And then I went and saw my good friend from Georgetown and Columbia, Glenn O'Brien, and his wife, Judy. And they said, we'd like to be part of this. And so I went back and said, I'll work for $50. My friend Glenn O'Brien will work for $40, and his wife will be our first intern. And that's how we got started. And the next day, I went to work, and Paul Morrissey said to me, oh, we're leaving for the Venice Film Festival, and we'll see you in a couple of weeks. And I was like, you're all leaving? I mean, what am I supposed to do? I mean, the boss is leaving. He was like, and he handed me an envelope filled with Rita Hayworth stills, you know, publicity stills, and said, just put one of these on every page. And then you go to this hippie magazine, they do the layouts. Then you go to this printer in Chinatown. And I was like, wow, this is like, you know, but somehow it worked out, even though we had reviews of all these intellectual European films and underground films. I put Rita Hayworth, because I was brought up to do what your boss told you, so we put Rita Hayworth on every page.
And it was a film journal in the beginning.
It was a film, it was called Inter/View,
yeah.
A film journal, and when the magazine was printed, well, the Chinese printer couldn't understand English, so we kept saying, less ink, less ink, less ink, and it just kept out coming out pure black. So half of the 5,000 print run we had to throw away. The other half, Paul said we should deliver to Anthology Film Archives and leave like a few hundred there. Anthology Film Archives was the center, the sort of the Vatican of underground film, and this was run by a man called Jonas Mikas, who was this Czech emigre, an escapee from Nazism, very, very intellectual. And he starts going through this issue with Rita Hayworth on every page, and he says, you are a genius. You have reinvented the magazine. This is brilliant. The text has nothing to do with the photographs. This is brilliant. So that was my start as an editor.
Jonas was a big man in the underground film world at that time, but that is good. That's a great story.
But Andy hired all of us very young. I mean, Vincent, you were like 19 or 20, and he kind of, I guess, first, we'd work cheaply. Secondly, we would
I was $65 a week.
Yeah. Thirdly, like he kind of got to shape us in his... Although I think, you know, we all came there like you did with, you know, already being sort of fans. And so we had the same sensibility.
Well, Andy gave us all our opportunities to really, you know, develop. He gave you, if he trusted you, he gave you more. And if you succeeded in his trust, and he gave me more responsibility after more responsibility. Because he made me vice president of Andy Warhol Enterprises by 1974. I was 24 years old.
It only had six employees.
So the title sounded really good, but the money was about the same. But what you learned, though, is if you made Andy money, you made money. So he was very good at giving commissions. So if you sold things, sold ads, every one of us had to go out at night. We had fun, but the thing was, Bob was very good at getting portrait commissions. I was trying to get, I got the first full, like, 6 month contract for Pioneer Electronics to go for Interview Magazine.
Where and I sit, owed the money.
And that's Packer Electronics.
Yeah, there's a whole chapter in Holy Terror called Portraits and Ads, Ads and Portraits.
I'll set you up for this. When Brigid had this, Brigid lived at the George Washington Hotel.
But before that, the Chelsea.
The Chelsea. But you and she owed money to the electronics store next door to where you went into Andy's 33 Union Square West. So she also owed Mickey Ruskin money. So why don't you give your route from the George Washington Hotel to meet me?
I had to walk at least 15 blocks. So I didn't pass Packard Electronics. to meet Vincent, which Vincent was on the same block as Packard. And, you know, one of the really funny things was Andy used to say to me, I mean, think of how dumb I really am. He'd say, what do you want for Christmas? and I'd say, Andy, anything, but not a painting. And he'd say, well, what do you want? And I'd say, an Electrolux vacuum cleaner. And he'd say, go get it, but don't forget to bring me the receipt. If I learned anything in 40 years from Andy, it was keep receipts.
Get the receipt. That was his name.
I saved receipts for a $1.60 container of boysenberry yogurt. I still have them. And the next year it was, well, Bridge, well, what do you want for Christmas? Well, Andy, anything, but not a painting. And I wanted one of those stackable washers and dryers. Go get it and bring me the receipt. I got stuck one year with the painting. And it was the most hideous thing I had ever seen in my life. And it was a poinsettia.
It was a Christmas painting.
They weren't very good.
I hated poinsettias. And I'd stick it
Well,
up.
The thing is, you know, when I first saw Andy painting the mouse, I think for the first series he did, when I think, because after he was shot, he didn't have that much energy, and he didn't really get back to painting big paintings until, I think, 72 with the mouse.
Well, 72.
He was doing mostly commission portraits, which he figured out pretty quickly that I was a pretty good salesman. Both my parents were salespeople in a way. And so he would start saying to me, well, if you get these ladies to have their portraits, you know, I will give you 20% commission. And then whenever I, you know, be at a party, say, did you pop the question? Did you pop the question to Lily Auchincloss? That was like, did you ask them to have their portrait done? And sometimes it was hard because they thought, I'd say, Andy wants to do your portrait. They thought it was for free. Then you'd have to explain it was $25,000 for one and $15,000 for each one after that. But I got pretty good at it. And so, but.
Between Bob and Fred Hughes, Andy's main business manager, they were the ones who are most productive in bringing.
What I just wanted to say was that, so at first I was very impressed seeing Andy paint these beautiful Mao paintings, and then came like the skulls, and after a while it was like, what's Andy churning out this week? You know, how many of those has he done? So he started to take for granted, you know, how important he was as an artist. Every so often when I'd go to Europe with him, where he was like a god, and all the most serious newspapers, the most serious collectors and critics were clamoring for his work and to meet him, I'd realize he's really important. But in New York, like, we never saw other artists. We mostly had socialites for lunch and models and people who had, and advertisers. And Jasper Johnson, all these ivory tower artists would look their nose down on Andy and sort of treat him like he was still a fashion illustrator or something. Museum of Modern Art would never hang a painting of his, let alone give him a show. So, you know, it was very easy to, in New York especially, to think, you know, Andy was kind of the boss. He was churning out the art, and like he would give us little paintings for Christmas and sometimes for your birthday. But you know, when I think about it, I should have like deferred a week's salary and got something else.
You know, hang your portrait in your bathroom.
For a long time, I hung it in storage. and it didn't really look like me. I looked too handsome.
But you know, in Andy's lifetime, he was the undervalued pop artist. The prices were very low at auction, so he always said everybody was better than he was, all his peers, Roy and Rosenquist. So that was it. Andy was taken for granted. I mean, he was put down for being just doing social portraits and going out too much with,
even for making movies and having a newspaper.
They wanted Andy to be the lonely artist in the studio. You know, maybe a heavy drinker. Being moody, but Andy's world was, he loved to see what was going on. He was curious. That was part of his art, to go out.
That was so much a part of my being with Andy, was I finally decided that I couldn't hack the back room of Max's every night with Candy Darling and Jackie Curtis and Andrea Feldman dancing on tabletops and what have you. I thought, I really want to meet the intellectuals, the real artists. So I became really good friends with Bob Rauschenberg, Robert Smith's and Carl Andre, who was nothing else but a murderer.
What? Talking to the mic.
Talking to the mic. If you can't hear, let us know, because thank you.
And, you know, I'd go back to Bob Rauschenberg's house every night at 4 in the morning when Max is closed, or to Larry Poons's, and I thought I was really with the intellectual artist, the real artist.
Your heavies.
Like, and I called them the heavies, like staying up all night at Larry Rivers. Larry Rivers taught me the art of an X-Acto knife and how he punched everything in and out with that knife. And, you know, he'd have all these 16-year-old girlfriends, and I'd have to go out and get in the car with them at 8:30 in the morning to deliver the girlfriends to high school. I mean, it was just mad. But one of the things about Bob that I loved so much.
But you hated me for a couple of years.
Yeah, but then I really, really, really loved
you. Wasn't it 5 years you gave him the mean look? 5 long years?
But I had fun, really fun working with Bob, and I could call it work. And I'd go to his apartment, this is after I left the factory, at 470th every morning. And some mornings the doorman would say to me, "Miss Berlin, Mr. Colacello doesn't feel like working today."
Because I was just getting home, probably.
And I'd sit there, and Bob would sit on his couch in his living room, screaming because Paul Wilmot had sent him a television set that was half the size of this room. And then he would proceed to dictate the diaries to me. He'd have his little short bathrobe on. He'd have to have a few tokes to get right
in the
there.
Mood.
And then I think that Bob really loved working with me because I was a good audience. I laughed myself crazy, huh? It was true, right?
Well, we wrote exposures that way, actually.
You guys were a good team.
That was Andy's. I used to go to Bridget's apartment about 4 o'clock. I'd work all day at interview, and then around 4:30, I'd say, well, I got to go work in exposures, and I'd go over to Bridget's on 22nd Street, and I'd have a joint, and then I'd sort of imitate Andy. I had to write the text for exposures was a book of Andy's photographs, although about 25% of them were mine, but we called them Andy Warhols. And I got them all back from the foundation, I must say. So that there's no historical mistakes now. But, and I, you know, we'd say, okay, I said, Bridget, we got to write the Deanna Vreeland chapter. And then I would, like, start imitating Andy talking about Deanna Vreeland. And I would take something I remembered he said, like one sentence, and we'd sort of stretch it out to like a whole paragraph. And then Bridget would, when I got a little further, Bridget would say, "You don't sound like Andy anymore. Now it's Bob." And it was okay, you know, I'd have to go. But the book was funny.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And actually I got really upset when the book was sort of launched at the Corcoran Museum of Art and in a Gallery of Art in Washington, and the director said, "This book proves that Andy Warhol, on top of being a great artist and a great filmmaker, is also a great writer." And I was thinking, that's when I started thinking, I have to get away from this.
And the day, you know, there was a meeting, and this was the day that Bob decided he was going to quit. And he walked out of the dining room, and he said to me, "I quit." I went hysteric. I cried my eyes out. He left. I called him up at home, and I said, "Oh, Bob, come back. You've got to come back. I can't live without you. You're the only funny person I know. You're the only person that can tell really good stories. And everything is a good story with Bob. Anything he tells you, he has you on the floor laughing."
So
I mean,
get this
he
book.
So get this book. Buy this book. Buy lots of copies.
Oh yeah, from the Strand.
From That's the right. Strand. Is it Q&A time or should we keep going? We could go for hours, you know, you just push a button called Andy on one
we
of us.
We can totally move on to questions if you like. Yeah.
We so do questions.
Does anybody have any questions for our panel this evening? I can bring a microphone around to you. One in the middle.
So one of the things I'm kind of amateur student of the Warhol scene, and one of the things I've noticed that seems under-remarked is it's really very heavily Catholic mm-hmm. group, and I find that unusual. I mean, there's a lot
except
of
except for me.
Okay, but don't feel left out.
I don't.
But there are a lot of debauched ex-altar boys and convent school girls, and most avant-gardes in America and Europe have tended to be, I think, Jewish influenced, but the Warhol scene was heavily Catholic. Were you aware of that?
Yeah, Paul Morrissey especially. Yeah. But now, you know, Catholics, we grew up believing in mysteries and miracles. And I think Andy's approach, you know, he never explained what his art was about. He wasn't like Robert Motherwell or he wasn't Jewish, so he didn't analyze himself. I mean, he didn't. It's a different approach. So I think, you know, it's hard. I mean, we just did what we did, you know, and with Andy's work also is like everything, you know, people would look at it and they would say, is this a joke or is this for real? What they couldn't get was that it was both. It was a joke and it was for real. And I think, you know, in Europe, it was somehow not so much Jewish intellectuals were running the art world. In New York it was, and I think that was part of Andy's problem. And Andy, I mean, and I think Andy was making real icons. He wasn't Roman Catholic, though. He was Eastern Rite Catholic.
But he went to St. Vincent's Fair on 66th
yeah,
Street every Sunday.
But he
Sunday,
grew up going
but he
to,
didn't
a,
go
a
to the
Greek
whole
style
mass.
Church.
He went in and when it came out, but he went there.
But growing up, he was looking at the iconostasis. His mother would take him to three masses every Sunday because that was her whole life. And, you know, iconostasis is the screen of saints with gold background, Byzantine style, very flat, all butting up against each other, just like Andy's portraits. I wrote this in the introduction, as a religious artist for a secular society, that he was making icons of the, and he understood who were our saints, which were the symbols we worshipped, whether it was the dollar sign, the hammer and sickle, you know, I mean, Mao, Lenin.
Follow-up.
Yeah.
Did your folks go to confession? How long did that take?
Well, they don't have confession anymore. The Catholic Church, you don't have any nice rituals like no meat on Friday and stuff. I don't know what happened to all that stuff.
And Bob what? And I definitely were out of the whole group of us that ever came, we were the only two Republicans.
No, Paul Morrissey.
Paul Morrissey was a Republican.
Well, he was a Bouvier Democrat.
Yes.
Not a Kennedy Democrat. He was a Jackie and Lee Democrat.
But religion wasn't really spoken about within the factory during the day. But you didn't talk about family. You didn't talk about religion. Andy was very private with what he did. No one realized he did go to church every Sunday. Because I used to pick him up on Sunday sometimes to go places. And he always had to make a pit stop, so to speak, to go into the church. I'd wait outside, then we'd continue on. So that sort of stuff was always kept very, very private.
Oh, but Andy did care about family.
He did, but we didn't talk about. He didn't.
He didn't
never
tell
told us
that
about
his mother
dying
for 2 years.
Yeah,
and then was by accident.
Yeah, no, she. His mother died in 1972. We found
Barbara.
Out.
Hi,
my sister Barbara was director of advertising at Interview, hired by Andy, not by me.
He was coming to Yves Saint Laurent. He knew I was Bob's sister, so he'd come to me, and he bought a beautiful peach sweater. He said it was for his mother. And then would ask me if I would work at Interview, and I'd say, no, I don't want to work with my brother and know nothing about publishing. And then I told Bob, and Bob said, but his mother has been dead. Well, he bought her a sweater.
Well, Andy could be, was secretly, Andy liked to create mysteries about himself, even when he was starting to be successful in the 1950s as a fashion illustrator and commercial artist. I mean, making a lot of money, winning awards. So he'd get write-ups in these trade journals, and in one he would say he was born in Philadelphia, in another Newport, Rhode Island, in another Pittsburgh, which was
in different years.
McKee's
too.
In different years. So he was given future biographers more to, like, you know, try to figure out. I mean, he understood instinctively that mystery is a big part of fame. You know that.
And he definitely told different people different things about himself.
He was a liar.
Now,
a lot.
He never let me come up to his house. He said it's just a dump.
Which house?
66 Street.
How
like
about 1342 Lex?
I'd been there.
See, you went to 1342 Lex. The reason why you don't
get. He never let me into Lexington Avenue. I'd go to pick him up. I'd have to wait on the street for him.
But when the 66th Street house was finished, you know, Jed Johnson, who was his boyfriend, did this beautiful interior, and he didn't want anybody to know how great it was inside. It was with this fabulous museum quality furniture, beautiful paintings.
People see the house, they'll think I'm rich, and they'll never buy another painting.
Yeah,
I said, Andy, they don't buy paintings for you because they think you're poor. They're not doing it because.
So very few of us were up there, and it was it's true, but Bridget, you always had you and Andy had the perverse. Yeah, you talked about health, and you were his phone mate every morning.
Andy
so.
Liked people who fought back with him.
I mean, he Andy would call me up and literally
That's
say
he
to
he
me in the morning, Bridget, my balls are sore. What does that mean? I said, Andy, how am I supposed to know anything about sore balls? You know? And it would be, you know, if he'd call up the factory at 9 o'clock and he'd say hi, he'd say, what's new? I'd say, Andy, nothing's new. It's 9 o'clock in the morning. He said, are there any good invitations in the book? Andy, are you crazy? The mail hasn't come yet. Well, is Vincent there? Where's Vincent? Is he in a crabby mood? No, he's in the back. And then he'd say, well, did you do it last night? Was it a big cock? Oh yeah, Andy, I met this cute guy in Central Park. He was a baseball player. Well, was it big? And then he'd say,
he would also ask the same questions to ladies I was trying to sell the portraits to.
And then he'd say, is
sometimes
Vincent?
The sale fell through.
And here was the main question from the first from the beginning of the phone call. Is Vincent up in the front yet? Yes. Would you ask him if the check came in? And that meant for the portrait that he'd done at 2 o'clock the day before.
Well, it wasn't quite that fast. So I think we have
we
a question.
We do have another question right
here. We have a question over here.
Did he always do
Sir,
his... Did he always do his own painting? Or did he have other people paint?
No, he mostly did his own. Sometimes, I guess, Ronnie painted the background.
Well, historically, he had, you know, Nathan Gluck was his art assistant in the 50s going into the early 60s. Gerard Malanga was his assistant in the 60s. And then Ronnie Catrone was his assistant in the 70s going into the early 80s. So it was a very small group. And he really actually did paint. He remember in the 60s, he said he wanted to be a machine. He wasn't touching anything. I videotaped him in the 70s. Drag queens. He was very physical, and so actually
and
the machine.
And he mixed his own colors.
Yeah, and then he had assistants mix them. But if they did the wrong, did the wrong thing, that's when you saw Andy get mad.
And Jay.
No, ideas. You know, Andy was a poll taker. He would ask everyone he met, "Oh, what should I do next?"
And he was a good editor too.
And he would then seize upon an idea when he knew it was an Andy Warhol idea. You know, he would just. But he, a lot of his dealers actually commissioned, like Iolas commissioned the Last Suppers. Anselmino of Torino, we used to call him, commissioned the drag queens. But sometimes, like, we were in Italy showing the drag queens at the Palazzo di Diamante in Ferrara, and there was a press conference, and Andy always wanted me or Bridget or somebody to sit next to him during interviews. So I was sitting up there with him, and communism was very fashionable in Italy in the middle 70s, and all these journalists were asking, isn't it true that these are really Marxist paintings, that you're saying these black and Puerto Rican boys, you know, become transvestite prostitutes because that's the only thing capitalist American culture allows them to be. And then he's going, not really. Or, I don't know, Bob, what do you think of that? But at one point he leaned over and said, they really want communist art in Italy. I got to make more communist art. So the next thing I knew, we go back to New York and Ronnie Catrone's going to a hardware store and coming back with all these hammers and literally hammers and sickles. And he's taking Polaroids of them. And sure enough, the first big hammer and sickle painting was sold to Johnny Agnelli, you know, the richest man in Italy. And so that's how, you know, the ideas came from different places.
And originally, the hammer and sickle and Andy did skulls, they were supposed to be shown together. Skulls representing fascism to people and the hammer and sickle communism. In fact, they were deconstructed the thing. They were still lives. But we had to cancel the show in Italy because of the political atmosphere was so extreme. The people were afraid they were going to throw bombs through the windows. So Leo Castelli actually only showed the hammer and sickles here in New York.
And of course, the big poster of Nixon.
No, it was
but vote for McGovern, and it was Nixon's portrait.
Well, I think he thought Nixon was more interesting face.
Do you have one at the...
Yeah.
We have one at the back over here, too.
How did you get that? You know how you fired
the... Well, the story is that a friend of his gave him the idea to do gave camel soup and dollar bills. And he paid her $50 for the first idea, and she gave him the camel.
It's been written about.
It's pretty well documented. Wait, there's someone back there that's been waiting.
I have two unrelated questions, but I just want to get them out. The first question is, you talked about his relationship with some of the dealers, and could you tell us about his relationship with Castelli, and why it took Castelli a while to warm up to him, as we hear? And then the second question is, you know, you reminisce a lot about the 60s and 70s, but for those of us who grew up in Manhattan, in this neighborhood, in the 80s, we all remember AIDS so well. And can you just talk about how that affected the factory and Andy and all of your relationships?
Well, the first death from AIDS, just to answer that question, was Robert Hayes. When I left Interview in early 83, Robert, who had been managing editor for several years, became editor. And within a year, he had developed AIDS, and it was terrible because people would die, like in a matter of months, from pneumonia and Kaposi sarcoma. And then Andy's last boyfriend, John Gould, died of AIDS. So I mean, it came pretty close.
Andy was terrified about AIDS, and to the point because there wasn't a lot of information back in 82, 83, 84, where he would be paranoid if he sat next to somebody who knew might be sick or there was a fork or utensil he wouldn't touch. He was very germophobic in general anyway. And it comes out in his paintings. The later hand painted paintings, AIDS Jeep comes to mind. But going back to Leo Castelli never really understood Andy.
I agree.
Ivan Karp was the one who really brought him into the gallery. Leo was, you know, a great dealer, but he was focused on Jasper Johns, Robert Rauschenberg, Roy Lichtenstein. And this is where Andy's was brilliant. He realized he had to start his own gallery. So by his association with Fred Hughes, they started in a kind of a gallery within his studio, Fred being the person to run it as the director. Always he negotiated all the exhibitions so Andy could make, you know, choose and pick what he wanted to do. And Fred, in his brilliance at that point, because the two of them together were, that was the 70s was great, was to start exhibiting in Europe and not so much here in the United States, where he's being taken for granted. And Bruno Bischofberger and later Thomas Simon and other European dealers did beautiful shows that were not really seen here. So Leo, if you go into Andy's diaries and you look for look up Leo Castelli, there's not much you can really find that Andy goes, oh, he doesn't know how to sell my work. Oh, look, there's his wife drunk dancing. You know, so they liked each other, but to go after Andy died, I had lunch with Leo, and Patty Brundage is one of his right hands at his favorite restaurant and his favorite table, and I asked him what he wanted to do with the estate, and nothing ever came of that conversation. And the next thing we knew, guess who was knocking on the door? Larry Gagosian.
Yeah. Leo was very formal.
Well, he was also a European intellectual, and he was too. He it was too intellectual for Andy in a way to get Andy. Ileana Sonnabend, his ex-wife, I think understood Andy's work much more, and she did the beautiful show in Paris in 65 of wallpaper, how wallpaper and the silver helium pillows that...
That was at Leo's, but she did the big flower painting exhibition in Paris.
Leo had a... No, you know, she...
Ileana.
She did the wallpaper that was...
Wallpaper is Leo. But Ileana was very smart. She kept lots of work. I mean, not just Andy's, but she really was. She was the one that really had an eye and did actually, Bob's absolutely right, understood Andy's importance more.
And Andy got Ileana to give me a show.
That's right.
With Gilbert and George.
The first time Gilbert and George were in New York. Bridget was the other
artist. Did you have
artist.
A question, Colin?
Yes.
No, once he said to me that Duchamp was his main influence, but he was collecting surrealists when he started making a little money in the 50s, and quite a bit of money. He was buying surrealist prints, and I mean, the artists we sort of socialized with, we saw, Roy Lichtenstein would come to lunch every so often, Larry Rivers a lot, because he was more like Andy, he was like an outlaw, he was, you know, he was making videos, he had young girlfriends, he was more pop in his whole lifestyle, let's say.
Dolly.
Andy and Dolly, and Andy always used to say, I never can figure out if Dolly got drag queens from me or I got drag queens from Dolly. and Andy was obsessed with doing Dolly's portrait and trading portraits, and his wife Gala would say, no trade oil painting for photograph, you photographer. And Andy hated her, of course, and but was always trying to win her over, and it never happened, actually.
Yeah, because Andy kept relationships with Roy and Rauschenberg, in fact, too, as well, because Rauschenberg would show up, and one time he did show up at 860 Broadway with a big bandage on his head because he had fallen down some marble steps the night before, and Andy got him to pose for a number of Polaroids, which were fantastic. But they had a great relationship when Rauschenberg sold a painting of Andy's for $1 million, which was a lot, and this was probably the early 80s. He called Andy first to say he was selling the painting that they had traded many years before to help for his foundation. So I thought that was a really telling moment that one artist would call another artist to say, listen, I'm selling your painting, and just to let him know. And it was, it was like close to $1 million, which sounds like a little small amount, but Andy's top dollar at the time of his death, the highest auction was $600,000. Sorry? I don't know. That's too long ago.
Sorry.
But I mean, now, Andy, the highest painting at auction right now is $105 million.
Okay, we have another question over there.
So the last one that we have time for this evening.
Could you talk a little bit more about the change that takes place in the factory after the shooting? Because Andy had a 10-year career before that, and then this change takes place, and I just was curious about how you perceived it.
Well, the new decade was starting. So when I met Andy in 69, there comes 70, 71. I didn't meet Bob. I left to go back to California the December of, January of 70 because of the draft. So I didn't get back to New York until the end of 70. And Bob had arrived. So I go on staff in 71. But it's a changing times. And Fred Hughes and Paul Morrissey were kind of in battle who was going to be the Andy's manager. Fred finally prevailed, and Fred wanted more order. So did Paul, but they got rid of all the hangers-on. And, you know, after Soren Agnew, and then there were a lot of pretenders hanging around, pretending they were lawyers and people. And then we had drag queens coming up every afternoon. That was the ascent of drag queens in that period. So don't you agree, Bob? It was
sometimes
we started wearing ties.
Oh, you kids are so boring, you know, and then we'd say, you know, the drag queens were so much more creative than the amphetamine addicts. And we say, well, bring them back, Andy, and get shot again. But, you know, we got a little wilder, and things got wilder and wilder as we got into the late 70s, the Studio 54 era. But basically, we were all, you know, workers. It was a different, and it was a business.
And Andy was a workaholic.
And Andy was a workaholic and wanted us all to be workaholics. And I think the art he did in the 70s and 80s, some of it's really great, some of it's maybe a little less great, but I think there used to be this idea that only the stuff done from 62 to 64 was really good. That idea has faded, and I think you know, Andy was always creative and always trying to push things, you know, in some new direction.
And he even loved quantity. If I typed, you know, one cover page and handed him 50 blank white pages of typing paper, and there was one page typed on the end, he'd say, "Oh, Bridge, this is so great. You typed 33 today. That means you can type 35 tomorrow." You know? He really loved amounts.
On that note.
Wonderful. Well, special thanks to Bob, to Bridget, and to Vincent all for joining us for this evening's panel. It's been lovely. Please make sure you stick around to get your book signed. We do have more available at the back of the room. Everybody have a lovely evening. Thank you.